Barefoot Journey community, as we are gathered today, I want to take a minute and just say that however you are gathered, whether it's in person or virtually, no matter where you are or with who you are with or what time it is, that the presence of Christ is in you. And I pray that in this moment, the Holy Spirit would fill wherever you are, would fill the space, would fill your life, and illuminate to you what God is calling you to. Today, we are only going to have a teaching on our virtual gathering, and my hope is that with the extra time that we have today, that maybe you'll brew a cup of coffee or go for a walk and have a conversation about what the Holy Spirit is calling you to share that with another is a wonderful thing. And I hope that we will all take advantage of that today. We're going to take a few moments to breathe deeply, allow ourselves to set aside any distractions that might prevent us from being attentive to the Holy Spirit, and to invite Jesus to speak to us in these moments. Well, hello everyone, how are we today? My name is Jonathan, and I have the privilege of being pastor here at Journey, and it is so, so good to be gathered together with you today. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas. Today is, or at least the day in which this video is created for, is December 27th, which is the third day of Christmas. A lot of people don't know that Christmas is not just one day a year, that the song, The 12 Days of Christmas, it's not a countdown to Christmas. It's a celebration that begins at Christmas and goes for 12 days after that. So if you haven't already, I want to encourage you, leave up those Christmas decorations for a few more days. Sing the Christmas carols for a few more days. Allow the arrival of Jesus in human form to consume your minds for the next few days, and look for ways in which to proclaim through your actions and interactions the hope and peace and joy and love that is present and at the forefront of this season. I hope that regardless of how you celebrated Christmas this year, that it was a time of joy and celebration. I know that for many of us, we were unable to celebrate in the ways that are familiar to us, but each experience that we have in life, whether it's as we desire it to be or something different, is an opportunity for us to be present and to be attentive to what is going on around us. So I pray that and hope that for all of us, we were able to get past all of the things that we're missing this year, and able to be present to that which was still present, that was still there for this year. So as we gather this week and next, we are still in the Christmas season, and today we are a few days removed from opening gifts, and hopefully all of us received something that provided for us a little bit of joy, a little bit of happiness that helped us to be able to know of someone else's love for us and appreciation for us. You know, when we receive a gift or we listen to some new music, or we watch a new TV show, or we eat at a great new restaurant, one of our primary responses to these things in our lives is to share it, right? Almost immediately after we have experienced something wonderful, we move into this mode of, man, I have got to share this with someone, right? I've got to tell somebody about it. And we pick up the phone or we plan a time where in the future where we can come back to eat at this restaurant. I can bring someone else with me who wasn't here. Or we send in a text message, hey, you got to listen to this, or hey, you got to watch this. Or we take, go and get the movie and take it to them if we're a little bit old school. But these are natural responses to the things that are moving to us, that captivate us, that capture our attention, that grab at us, that is something that we can't describe enough with enough joy and enough love for whatever this thing is. We just simply have to share it. When we lived in Ohio, one of my friends, I remember it like it was yesterday, on a cold and gloomy Ohio winter day, took me to a Vietnamese restaurant to eat lunch. Now, up until that point in my life, I had very limited experience with Vietnamese food. And so I ordered what he ordered. I ordered it a little bit more spicy than what he liked it, but I ordered a bowl of soup, which is a huge bowl, and the meat in it was meatballs and pork strips. And there were sprouts in there, and cilantro, and jalapenos, and all of these good and delicious spices with rice noodles. It was absolutely wonderful. And on that cold, dreary day, my soul and my mind and my body were filled with this delicious, wonderful food that warmed me up from head to toe. And after that experience, whenever I would invite someone out to lunch, generally I would say, hey, I know this great Vietnamese restaurant. We should go and check it out. If you've never been there, it will change your life. I took Kelly there for dinner one evening. Kelly was teaching school then, and we went back for dinner, and she loved it. Most everyone who I took there loved eating there and then would return on their own and tell me about it, or would turn around and invite me back out to lunch and suggest that we go there. We got to know one of the waitresses really well. Her name was Cece, and she was always the one who took care of us when we went in there. She knew my order before I even sat down, and we got to know her so well that Kelly and I even gave her a gift one time when we ate there. But I remember one of these experiences with my friends. He was more of a meat and potato kind of person. He never really ventured outside of what he liked. He knew what he liked, and he liked what he knew, and that was plenty for him. And he also wasn't really a fan of things that were terribly spicy. And so he graciously went along with me when I invited him out to the Vietnamese restaurant. And when we sat down, you know, when you go into a restaurant that you're not familiar with, it can be a little bit intimidating ordering from the menu because you don't know exactly what everything is, right? And so he did what many of us do, what I actually did the first time there with my friend, and I said, hey, you know, I'll have whatever you're having, right? And so I said, well, hey, just so you know, it's delicious, but it's pretty spicy, so if you don't want it to be terribly spicy, you know, we'll order it differently. And he said, no, I'll have it however you like it. I said, okay. So we ordered it, and about five bites into his experience, his face turned beet red, and smoke was exiting out of his ears. He even asked for my permission not to finish eating the soup. And to my knowledge, he has never eaten Vietnamese food since then. You know, over the years, when we lived in Ohio, I probably introduced at least 10 people to Lynn's Bistro. And nearly all of them became fans. And it wasn't because I convinced them to like it. And it wasn't because I defended the five reasons as to why this was the best food that you'll ever taste and why they also should love it. They enjoyed it and returned to it simply because it was delicious. All I had to do was make a reservation and bring them to the place and sit them down, and they ate it and they learned to love it for themselves. Over the next few weeks, you and I are going to be evangelists of our Christmas gifts. Some of us this very day are going to share with others about how delightful something is that we received for Christmas. You're going to evangelize that new sweater that you received, or you're going to share that new game that you were gifted to a friend. We are all evangelists. And we don't need training to share the things that we love and that we like. We share them because they bring so much joy to us. They invoke some sort of wonderful emotion in us that we just can't do anything but share it. Right? We it's the first thing on our mind. I have to share this. And the reason why we do that is because we believe that the thing that we are sharing is going to bring joy to someone else, just like it brought joy to us. Yet many of us often feel inadequate to share the hope and peace and joy and love that we find in Jesus. Either because we think we don't know how, or because we fear how someone will respond to our sharing. But the reality is that simply what we are called to do is to be faithful witnesses. That's it, right? We are simply called to setting up a time and saving someone a seat and allowing them to experience for themselves the same joy and hope and peace and love that we experienced. Our scripture today is from Luke chapter 2. Beginning in verse 22, and I want to read it for us this morning. It's the time when Jesus, after his birth, was presented at the temple. And here's how the scripture begins. It says, "When the time came for the purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it was written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. So moved by the Holy Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was custom of the law, of what the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, 'Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and a hope of your people Israel.' The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, 'The child is destined to cause the falling and the rising of many in Israel, to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. A sword will pierce your own soul too. There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then had been a widow for 84 years. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong and was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was on him. Jesus, we ask today that through the reading of your word and the conversation surrounding it, that you might lead us to be people who never take for granted, who are never unresponsive, and who are constantly awakening to new wonder and praise of your goodness. We ask it in your name and for your sake. Amen. Now, these blessings found in this scripture were of great significance for Joseph and Mary. When you consider all that they endured over the last several months, to have all of that validated by Simeon and Anna was of paramount importance to them. These were people who were looked up to in their society. They were sages. They were people who others looked to for wisdom and trusted for their example. And they proclaimed, identified with the witness that Mary and Joseph both had received from the angels, that God was indeed with them and that Jesus was indeed the Son of God. And this is a great example of others being led by the Holy Spirit to speak life and love and truth into the lives of people that the Holy Spirit brings their way. I love the fact that it begins by saying it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit, and moved by the Holy Spirit, he went into the temple courts. That is our prayer as Journey Community, that it would be revealed to us by the Holy Spirit, and that the Holy Spirit would move in us to be present to whomever God is calling us to. That's what it means to never be unresponsive, that we want to invite the Holy Spirit to illuminate to us what God is calling us to. We believe that there is no such thing as scripture being read or a truth being told that isn't coupled with some sort of calling, right? This isn't just for our memorization. It isn't just something that we agree to believe in. It is a calling. So when the Holy Spirit moves in our lives, when, as the scriptures talk about, the Holy Spirit comes upon someone, there is a calling, there is a leading, there is a pulling, there is a nudging to something. And that's what Simeon and Anna both are aware of, and that is obvious in this passage. But even with all of that, what I was drawn to in this story, however, is the unique responses of Simeon and Anna. Simeon, being a righteous and devout person, was promised by the Holy Spirit that he would see the Messiah before he died. So once he recognizes Jesus as the Son of God, he's ready to die, right? Let me go in peace. I've seen what you promised me. I am ready to go. Anna's response, though a lot shorter in the text, is much different. She was well advanced in years, especially when you consider the life expectancy of her day. She was when she was old enough to be married, you know, anywhere from 12, 13, something like that is when people normally got married. She was married for 7 years. And then after that point, she had been a widow for 84 years, the scripture tells us. So she is more than likely over 100 years old. She has lived for a very, very long time, especially considering the day in which she lived. And in the last days of her life, she notices Jesus, and her response to him is, now it is time to live. This is the one who will bring redemption, is her response. And what we see unfolding here is that Anna, an advanced in age widow, becomes the first Christian evangelist. This is the Messiah who come, and now it is time for us to live. This is Jesus, the Son of God, who will redeem and restore us, who will bring to us hope and peace and joy and love. Anna declares, open up your eyes, for the Messiah is here. Something that we don't often think about is that before Christmas, right, before the arrival of Jesus, Jesus was active in creation. In fact, since the beginning, Jesus has been active in creation. His birth in human form isn't the beginning for him. It is a continuation of the work that was being done since the beginning. In John 1, we read, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and through the Word all things were made. Right? Jesus was active and up to something long before he arrived in a manger. This is important for us to remember, because sharing hope, peace, joy, and love of Christ with others isn't about bringing Jesus to them. Rather, it's about joining Jesus in what he is already doing, helping others to see that Jesus is already there and has been working. Open up your eyes, for we have seen the Messiah. Our role in sharing the life of Christ with others isn't about convincing them to believe as we do. It's about pointing out the presence of Christ that is redeeming and restoring us and the creation. Simply put, we lift up Jesus. As we will read about later on in the gospel testimonies of Jesus, when the blind man was healed and he was questioned as to whether or not he was playing a trick on them, his response is, I don't know much, but I know that before I met this man Jesus, I could not see. I was blind, and since my interaction with him, I now see. It isn't about what I have decided or what I can convince you of. It is all about what he is doing. We lift up Christ when people ask, but we live Christ so people ask. This is why Advent and Christmas are so crucial to the Christian calendar. Hope and peace and joy and love, they rule the kingdom of God, and they should rule our hearts and lives as well. And if the hope and peace and joy and love of Christ rules our lives, then Jesus will speak for himself through our lives. Hudson Taylor, who was a great British evangelist, once wrote that what he called the cat and dog test, or what would later become called the cat and dog test. He said, if your father and mother, your sister and brother, if the very cat and dog in the house are not better and happier for you being a Christian, it's a question of whether you are really one. Right? The joy of the Lord is our strength. The peace of Christ rules and reigns in us. The hope of God fuels us, and the love of Christ compels us. If Jesus reigns in our lives and our main desire is to live according to his way, we will never have to convince anyone of hope and peace and joy and the love of Christ. They will know it because they will taste it, they will see it, and they will hear it. Lift up Christ when asked, but live Christ so people ask. Let's pray together. Jesus, we are grateful for this Christmas season to be focused on your hope, your peace, your joy, and your love. But Jesus, just as the gifts under the tree that we opened are too good not to share your hope and peace and joy and love, we cannot contain nor conceal these things. We have to share it, because if we don't, it will lose its influence over us. So Jesus, as we share your hope and joy and peace and love through our actions, not through knocking people over the head or wrestling them into mental submission or patronizing them until they give in, but just simply by being present, would you work in our lives? Would you lead us? Would we be so attentive to your Spirit that you would be able to lead us to where you are already working, so that we might be able to see you and simply say, look, the Spirit of the Lord is here. Jesus, would you help us to see that no matter how dark or grim or hopeless we might see the future, that is all the way of the world, that your way is hope and peace and joy and love. So would you replace our inclinations to despair with your love? And would you fuel us forward to be present to where you are calling us to be? We ask these things, Jesus, today in your name and for your sake. Amen. Now, Journey, please allow me to speak a benediction today. May the same Spirit that led Simeon and Anna to declare God is here be present in your life for the sake of others. Journey, beloved brothers and sisters, be present today in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.